Right, John 15, that's where we're going to be today. Get your Bibles out or your devices. You can mark that. We'll be there in just a little bit. So my oldest son is 15 now, and that's a little scary because he's driving. I've been tasked with the responsibility of teaching him to drive, and that's probably a good thing because if my wife had taken that responsibility, if she was the one teaching him to drive, he probably would not be allowed to drive until he was like 18 or 20 or like out of the house, you know, and then she didn't have to worry about it. So he's only run a few stop signs, right? So we're getting better. It's testing me. I'm learning as well, right? Because I'm learning patience. I'm learning how loud my voice can be inside a car, right? So there's a lot of very interesting moments that we've had over the last couple of weeks. Month or so. So it's been good. It's been really good. And I've noticed something, right? Right now we get to a stop sign, we get to a stoplight, we get to an intersection, and he asks the question, where do I go? Which direction do I turn? And at first it was an odd question. It's like, of course you turn right, you know, but I've been doing this a long time. And for him, he doesn't necessarily know. He's not paying attention, especially not now because he's on his phone. He has no idea where he is. And I'm the worst about knowing where to turn. Anyway, I'm horrible with directions. But he asked the questions like, where do I turn? What am I supposed to do? Where am I going? What do I do? And I thought about that in the context of how that question works really a year from now. Because he's asking that question right now. But a year from now, it's going to be me asking the question as he grabs the keys off the table and heads out the door. And I'm like, yo, where are you going? What are you doing? And I think about that in our Christian life as well. Like when we're young and we're just passionate, we're coming to God, like where am I going? Where do you want me to turn? What do you want me to do? Where am I going? But as we settle in, as life happens, as circumstances change, as we get comfortable, we just kind of go. And we do life. And God often is like, where are you going? What are you doing, right? Are you going in the direction? Are you turning the right way? Are you supposed to? We talked about that last week. We talked about what it looks like to abide in Jesus. It means to be close to him. So Jesus is on this journey, right? He's trying to take us, get us closer to the Father, and we'll get distracted in many ways, and we'll wander. And when we're abiding is being aware of that and recognizing that we've got to catch up. We've got to be in this relentless pursuit, in this relationship with him. We're going to see how deep of a relationship that Jesus wants with us when we look at this today. And so last week, we were reading out of the same chapter that we were in last week, because we're going to go deeper in the chapter this week. And so as we looked about the abiding, staying close to Jesus, then when you're growing and you are letting Jesus tell you which way to turn, you're allowing him to guide you, right? The idea of Jesus, my co-pilot, really Jesus is the pilot. Like he's the one that is giving direction. He's the one that's guiding you. And when we know that, right, when we're abiding in him, then we bear fruit, which is that external evidence of an internal health, right? That's true for every plant. And some people may, well, what is fruit? What is fruit? Like, what is that? When we say fruit, because Jesus uses this analogy of this plant, of this vine that produces fruit. What is it? What does it look like for us to be bearing fruit? Well, when you are growing in your faith in Christ, you begin to see and understand the grace and mercy that he has bestowed upon you, and you begin to bestow that grace and mercy onto others. You respond in a way that people don't understand. You show grace to your enemies, right? When somebody posts something online, and you respond in love, right? While everybody else is throwing vitriol, right? When someone you recognize is hurting and you don't ignore it because you're busy, you take time to invest in that person. Like those are things, right? Those are things you do. Or even when people see that stuff, they see you responding differently. They listen to your language. They watch your actions, okay? That's bearing fruit. Because all those things, right, you're doing it out of an overflow of the love you have for God and wanting to keep his commandments and wanting to honor him and glorify him with your life. But when people see that, they benefit from it, And that's bearing fruit. They're looking at you saying, why are you forgiving that person who has hurt you? Why are you showing grace in this circumstance? Why are you going above and beyond to help this person in need? And as you begin to share with them the gospel, as you begin to point them back to the truth of what Jesus has done for us, then they get to benefit from that fruit. Because fruit is not for us, right? The fruit that we bear is for others. It's true on any plant, but it's also true for us. So we're going to read this chapter. We're going to begin to look at Jesus' commands to go. We're going to look over the next several weeks. Four different times in Scripture that Jesus says go, gives us a command to go. This is the first one, so it's carryover from last week. We're going to read most of this chapter. Let's start in verse 1, and we'll read to verse 17. Here we go. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. All right, let's pause right there for just a second, real quick. So this picture, this analogy, this illustration, this metaphor of Jesus being the vine, and we're the branches, and the Father is the vine dresser. So he's the gardener, he's the expert, he's the one who knows how to make the plants really thrive. And the vine, right, the heart of the plant is Jesus, and the branches, the ones that go out and produce the fruit are us. And here's what it says. It says that he prunes them. Now, I'm not a botanist, okay? I do not have a green thumb. I do have roses in my front yard, and that's roses, I should say. Okay, I have a rose plant, all right? When it blooms, it looks like one petal, okay? If I was really going to take that plant seriously, I would come in and I would cut parts of the plant off, especially dead branches and things that weren't producing, because it pours more nutrients into the part of the plant to produce a better flower. In fact, when you buy those nice, pretty roses on Valentine's Day, that they're beautiful, somebody somewhere has taken care of a plant and has taken a petal and a bloom that's not as pleasant and has cut it so that the one is beautiful, and that's the one you cut off and you sell. That's pruning. So when it says that he's pruning, what he's doing is he's cutting away the junk, right? He's helping us thrive so that we bear more fruit, right? Okay, everybody get that? That's what the Father's doing. He is helping us. And we'll see later with the power of the Holy Spirit, but that's who we are. So here we are. In verse 3, already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch that withers, and the branches are gathered and thrown into a fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. For this, my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. That was the verse we looked at last week. That's our theme verse for the year, right? By this, my Father is glorified, bear much fruit and so prove to be disciples. Here we go. Verse 9. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. There's this theme that's beginning to come in. Like, as Jesus has set the example in what he has taught and how he has demonstrated grace and mercy and love, he said, as I have done that, so you can do that. Abide, like, stay close to me and live like I am living. Abide in my love. Verse 10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments, and I abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full, right? There's joy. So he's talking about love, he's talking about joy. You go back to chapter 14, he's talking about peace. Does that sound, where else have we love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control, right? That's Paul, Galatians 5. The fruit of the Spirit, right? Hey, here's Jesus talking about bearing fruit. And you look at those things, right? Love, what is love? It's towards others, right? Patience towards, right? So here he is. Like, this is what it's all about. Look, that for your joy and your peace, abide in me. Verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone laid down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. Now, we know what's about to happen. They don't necessarily know that he's going to lay down his life. No greater love than this, than one lay down his life for his friends. He's saying this just a few hours before he actually does this. He actually is nailed to the cross. So he's saying this, and then he says, you are my friends. You are my friends. We talk about having a relationship with Jesus. People are like, what does it mean to have a relationship with Jesus? He wants to be your friend. He wants to know you. He wants to love you. He wants to be with you. He wants to speak to you. He wants to guide you. He wants to help you. He wants to prune you. He wants to encourage you. He wants to grow you. Look, keep reading. He says, you are my friends if you do what I command you. Verse 15, no longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing, but I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father I have made known to you. Here we go. Verse 16. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you so that you will love one another. And in just a few hours, he's going to be nailed to a cross, demonstrating perfectly this love that he's talking about and offering freely the joy and peace that comes with faith and that sacrifice, that atonement. And that's not the end of the story, because he doesn't stay dead, right? They bury him. What happens 3 days later? He comes back from the grave. He has conquered death. He is resurrected. We place our faith and hope and trust in him because he has proven by his resurrection that everything he said was true and trustworthy, and that he is exactly who he said he was, and he is worth following and listening to. And if you keep reading, which you should, you see Jesus tell his disciples, this is not going to be easy. The world is going to hate you. They're going to hate you because they hated me. But you're not going to be able to do this if you try to do it on your own. And I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit. I'm going to give you a helper who's going to come and give you the strength to make this happen. And so we as believers, those who have placed their faith and trust in Jesus, who believe in the atonement of the cross, who believe in the resurrection, right, who have said, Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner and I am following you because you are the only hope of salvation and rescue. And so I am coming to you. And those who have done that have been blessed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives us strength. And apart from the Holy Spirit, we cannot do this. Apart from the Holy Spirit, we don't have the strength to abide. We don't have the strength to overcome the world. If we were not aware of what Jesus has done, we would be following everything that the world has said. We would be living in that tension of wondering why we can't ever find fulfillment and why we can't ever quench that thirst for hope and all the things that continue to let us down. But because we know and because we trust, because we follow it, we have hope, we have joy, we have peace, we know his love. And because the Holy Spirit is helping us, we can do exactly what he said, which is abide in him, bear much fruit. Now, I want us to look to this morning, focus on verses 16 and 17, because this is the heart of what he's saying, okay? And in verse 16, he says, you did not choose me, but I chose you. For sake of time, I'm going to rain check the conversations on predestination and free will. You come next week, you can ask that question, it'd be fun, or we can go get lunch some other time, which is probably a better idea if you want to talk about those subjects, okay? And I'm not sure that that's even what he's really talking about here. Because I know that some of these disciples chose to follow Jesus. That Jesus didn't ask them or pick them or point them out in a crowd and say, you, come follow me, that they heard about him and they followed him. They even brought people along with them. So I know that some of the disciples he's speaking to were not directly chosen. And so I read that, I'm like, what is he saying? Here's what he's saying. He's saying, I take responsibility for you. Because you can think about it backwards. You could say, if he were to say, look, I didn't choose you guys chose me. But then all of this is on them. Right? If they don't get it right, it's on them. But Jesus is saying, no, it's on me. This is my responsibility. This is my honor at stake. Okay? And I've chosen you to carry it forward. I've chosen you to listen to the truth and to bear the fruit so that others would see the truth. In fact, he doesn't stop with chosen, right? He says, I chose you and appointed you. Appointed you. Now, some translations say ordained, and the word in the Greek actually means called to a specific purpose, set apart for a special service. So Jesus has come to his disciples and said, look, I have chosen you. I have made it my personal responsibility to be concerned about your eternal well-being. And not just for your sake, but for everyone else's sake, because I'm not always going to be here. See, he knows when he's writing this, and we know the rest of the story, he's about to be gone. And he's telling his disciples, you have to do this. You have to get this right. This story cannot end here. So I have chosen you and appointed you to be the ones, that guard my honor, the truth, this love that I'm talking about for the next generation and the next generation. See, here we are today, right now, 2,000 years removed from that, and that's exactly what the disciples did, because he told them to go. He says, you're chosen, and then he says that you should go, appointed that you should go, and that's what they did. They go. They go, and they bear fruit, right? They act like Jesus. They speak like Jesus. They share the truth of Jesus. They share his life and his grace and his mercy. They live it out and everything they do. And then there are other people who see it, right, who benefit from the fruit they're producing. And then the next generation, same thing. And so we are the product of them going, of them being appointed. And here's what happens. So as Jesus said, I'm responsible for you. Listen, this is so important. As Jesus said, I chose you. I appoint you. I'm responsible for you. Those disciples had disciples. Those disciples had people who were listening and learning from them. And you know what they said to them? It's like, I choose you. I am appointing you, right? I have this responsibility to make sure that you know the truth. Because if you don't know the truth, then the person you're going to pour into when I'm gone is going to miss it. And that goes on and on and on and on to us today. So we read this, we're like, how does this apply to us? Well, this same message to Jesus' disciples then, it was this message his disciples said to their disciples all the way to us today. So it applies to us today. It could be us listening to that very thing. He has chosen us and appointed us to go. And going implies, right, forward motion. It's not a standing still. It's not a being comfortable. It's not a stepping back. It is a moving. In fact, the Greek word means to move on a course. And I ask, well, what is the course? Life is the course. It's going. He didn't tell the disciples to go this road, go this way, right? He didn't say go to the end of the block, turn left. He said go. The assumption was that they were doing so. The assumption was that they were going to go. And so his command to go was in your everyday living. To live is to go. In your life, in your home, in your workplace, at school, in your neighborhood, in the grocery store, at the sports bar, wherever you go, that's what Jesus is saying. Go. And the thing that we have to realize, right, is that unless we're dead or completely incapacitated, everything we do is our going. We are going. What Jesus is telling his disciples was the same thing that we've got to ask ourselves today, is what are we doing with our going? What does he say? He says, appointed that you should go and bear fruit. So as we're going around our friends, around our enemies, our family, when we're tired and weak, hungry, frustrated, lonely, see, it's easy sometimes to go and be like Jesus when everything's good and going well, right? It's when things are not going well. It's much harder to look like Jesus. When somebody says something that really upsets us, it's very hard to go and be like Jesus, to bear fruit, right? So he says, you were chosen to go and bear fruit. All right, now, but here's what I want you to see. Because we touched on bearing fruit last week. We touched on bearing fruit, right? Because fruit is not results. It is not works, right? That's not what it is. Fruit is the reflection of internal health and character, right? So when Jesus is the vine, we're the branch, okay? The fruit is showing that Jesus is in control, that he is the center of our life, that we are choosing to do things the way that he would do them and not the way that we would do them, that the world says to do them. It's why we abstain from certain substances. It's why we watch what we say. It's why we, monogamous marriage, all the things that we talk, all the things that we hold to the truth. It's like these things the world says crazy, and we're like, no, this is like Jesus. So we go, we bear fruit, right, so that people can see the truth in Jesus. We are doing these things. Listen. This is the most important part. Listen, he says this. Chosen, appointed to go bear fruit. But look what it says. That your fruit should abide. That your fruit should abide. Now, in this context, Jesus is referring to the bearing fruit, the love, the joy, the peace, everything that we've seen already. But when you read that your fruit should abide, we just read about or talked about that we should abide in him, but now our fruit should abide. What does that mean? Well, it means two things. In fact, John Piper says it this way. John Piper says that bearing fruit is loving people and winning people to Christ. That there's two things being said here. That your fruit should abide is saying this. One, your fruit should be a reflection of Jesus and nothing else. Right? Don't produce rotten fruit. We said that last week. Don't produce fruit of the world. Don't produce fruit stuff that... So truthfully, like, we can be doing things. We're doing stuff. We're going regardless of what we're doing in our life. But when Jesus is saying that we're producing fruit, it's his fruit. It's his love. It's his joy. It's his peace. It's his grace. It's his mercy. That's the fruit we're talking about. So number one, bearing fruit is reflecting Jesus and what we do, what we say, how we act, how we respond. But number two, it is reproducing disciples. Reflecting Jesus and reproducing disciples. That's what it means to bear fruit. And that fruit, right, that it should abide, is that it looks like Jesus looks. And if people are truly benefiting from it, then they're going to abide and be producing fruit that others benefit from, right? That's how this works. That's what started 2,000 years ago when Jesus told his disciples, that's why we're here today. That's what it means to produce fruit. Reflect Jesus and reproduce disciples. Now, I want to talk about both of those things really quick. Reflecting Jesus. This is the easy one to wrap our minds around because, I mean, people used to wear bracelets, you know, and we get the t-shirts, you know, Mountain Dew, you know, we get all the stuff. It's like, yeah, okay, I can look like Jesus. I probably have that t-shirt somewhere. What would Jesus do? Bracelet. We can do that, right? That's not what he's talking about, though. He's not talking about looking like a Christian. He's talking about behaving like he behaved, thinking like he thought, worshiping like he worshiped, speaking like he spoke, acting like he acted. So it's in your language. It's in your response to political posts online. It's in your consumption of substances. Are you telling a half truth, which is really a whole lie? Are you gossiping? The list goes on and on, right? Do you have any interest in ever taking care of the poor or widows, which is our, you know, modern day single moms? I mean, you have so many things that we can do to reflect Jesus. And we can say, like, what would Jesus do? So you think of some examples. Like, you open your Bible in the morning, and you're abiding in his word, you're growing in your spiritual health, and there's like this still small voice that says, you should text so-and-so because you heard they were going through a hard time. And you text them. That's reflecting Jesus. Because the other option is, I don't have time, I'll do it later, and you forget and you never do it. You restrain yourself from commenting on a particular post online, right? That could be reflecting Jesus. Or showing love when everyone else is not, right? So the examples are endless. Reflecting Jesus is the thing that we get, but often just miss the opportunities. We say things we don't mean to say, do things we don't mean to do, maybe miss opportunities to say things we should say, miss opportunities to do things we should do. And we know what we should be doing. We know what we should be acting. We get it. Just life is tough. It's challenging. It's difficult, right? Here's what I want you to do. Take just a minute right now, and I want you to think back this past week, right? Think about all the people you met, your workplace people, neighborhood, maybe family was over, watching a football game. We're not even talking about that. I'm not even going to talk about it, all right? Any of them. 2-yard line, man. I'm not going to talk about it. Think about last week. Think about your time on social media. Think about your time with your kids. Think about your time with your spouse. Okay? And here's the question. Is there a moment, and let me just go ahead and say this. Every one of us is going to say yes, okay? Don't say it out loud, all right? Just think about it. Is there a moment this past week where you missed an opportunity or did something you know was not reflecting Jesus? I missed an opportunity to reflect Jesus. Yes. And it's probably not just one. Could be 10, could be 100. I just want you to think about that, though. I want you to think about it. What would you have done differently? What should you have done differently? And then here's the question to follow up. Will you make the same mistake this week? Or will you go and bear fruit? So reflecting Jesus, that's one aspect of it. And that only happens because we have the power of the Holy Spirit. It only happens because we're focused on our own spiritual growth and health because we're abiding in Jesus, right? That's what we talked about last week. We're not producing fruit if we're not abiding in Jesus. We might think we're producing fruit, but it's all fake. It's all phony. It's branches with nothing. We don't want to be that because we read what happens. That's not good. That's not a good ending to that story, right? We don't want to be that. So if we're producing fruit, we've got to be in his word, we've got to be praying, we've got to be around people, you know, in groups and some association, something that's helping us grow, that's keeping us in check, that's making sure that we are abiding in Jesus, we're staying close to Jesus. Then we bear fruit and people see it because we act different, we think different, we respond different, we work different, we do different. And people begin to ask, man, why did you forgive that person? Why did you help that person? Why did you do that? Why did you speak that? Why did you do that? You can point it back to the gospel. Point it back to the truth. And when you begin to do that, you get into the second thing. That is, fruit should abide. And that's reproducing disciples. And this is much harder, right? And we're going to talk more about this in the next couple weeks. Because this takes way more time than just reflecting Jesus and how you live. This takes an investment. This takes an intentional focus and attitude and a desire to see other people around you making a decision to follow Jesus, right? That's what it means to reproduce disciples. I mean, Jesus is saying, right, that your fruit should abide. He's saying we need to be feeding, quote unquote, feeding those around us. That's Proverbs 10:21. The lips of the righteous feed many. Our growth strategy, right, we talked about this last week. Our growth strategy has always been in the church for new believers, right? To have new decisions to place their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. It's always been our growth strategy. That's what we want more than anything else. And then last week we said our goal over the next couple years is to see 100 new decisions for Christ. 100 people who choose to follow Jesus. Let me tell you something. That will never happen. It will never happen if we are not intentionally reproducing disciples, if we are not intentional about investing in the lives of the people around us to follow Jesus, to see the truth. And that will never happen if we're not bearing fruit, because there's no fruit for them. They don't see anything different in us. They don't see the truth. They don't see the joy. They don't see the peace. If they don't see that in us, I mean, what are they following? A good idea? So that reproducing disciples is harder, and we're going to talk more about that in the coming weeks. But I want you to do the same thing. I want you to take a look back, all right? Think back, take a moment, and ask yourself this. When was the last time outside of church, outside of small group, to someone that you know is not a believer or someone you know needs Jesus, needs the love of God proven to them, when was the last time you shared your faith? When was the last time you talked to someone about Jesus? Let me go a step further. When was the last time you intentionally had a conversation with someone about choosing to follow Jesus? Unfortunately, it should really upset us that is not happening more often than it is. Right? Now, I'm gonna fall into that category, but it's not just like this church. That's all over Western culture. I mean, that's a big issue everywhere. But it should deeply concern us that it's not happening more. Because that's how we got here. Because Jesus said, I've chosen you. I'm going to take a responsibility for you. And I'm going to pour into you. And his disciples did the same thing. Well, if we're here right now and we're not intentionally pouring into someone, what are we doing? If we're not intentionally growing ourselves to bear fruit so that other people around us see the love of God, experience it by us reflecting Jesus, then we're never going to have any opportunities to reproduce disciples. If we're not reproducing disciples, it's going to end. And we can't let it in. Because we are called, we're commanded to go. Bear much fruit that it should abide. And abiding fruit is reflecting Jesus and reproducing disciples. So let me ask you this question. What are you doing with your going? Are you bearing fruit? Are you reflecting Jesus? Are you reproducing disciples? What are you doing to be intentional about growing your own spiritual health, your own faith? And you may be sitting there like, nah, you know what? I'm not perfect. No one is. But I work really hard to be good, to reflect Jesus in everything I do. Awesome. Man, that's awesome. Are you reproducing disciples? Are you having those conversations with your coworkers and your friends and your neighbors and saying, hey, man, listen, you know why I act this way? You know why I did this? Because I follow Jesus. You follow Jesus? Do you know the love and joy and peace that can only come by knowing him? Now, I'll be the first to admit that's very difficult to do, right? I get it. But I'll also be the first to say that we got to do it. We got to get it right. We got to do a better job, for sure. We've got to go. And going means bearing fruit, and that fruit reflects Jesus and it reproduces disciples. I hope. In fact, here's my challenge. Here's the challenge I want to give you. The band's going to come up in just a second. I'm going to pray. The band's going to come up in just a second. We're going to close the service. But here's the challenge, right? You thought about last week one thing and that you did that you knew was not a reflection of Jesus. And that probably involved one person, right? And it could have been 10 and it could be 100, but let's just focus on one. Can you, responding to this week, go back to that person and ask for forgiveness or maybe do what you should have done? Can you be intentional about bearing fruit, reflecting Jesus, and maybe planting a seed that might end up resulting in reproducing a disciple? Can you do that this week? Can you take just one person, just one moment? You reflected back just a few minutes ago. Can you take that this week and maybe try to fix it? Maybe see if God will give you another opportunity to do it right this time. I pray you will. Pray with me. Father, your word is incredibly convicting to me personally. And I think about how many opportunities I've missed to be a reflection of you. How many opportunities I've walked away from to speak about my faith. It breaks me. And I'm not standing up here talking about this to try to be bigger or better. I am flawed deeply when it comes to bearing fruit the way I should. My prayer, though, as I am praying for strength and the courage to be better, that every person in this room would as well. That every person here would choose to go. They would choose to accept that command in their everyday life. Would look at every opportunity as a chance to give you glory. We need that. This community needs it. This church needs it. Give us the strength to do it. We pray all that in Jesus' name. Amen. Band's going to sing this song.